Welcome to a lesson on the limit of a vector-valued function. If we have a vector-valued function in two dimensions, or R2 as we see expressed here, or in three dimensions, or in R3 as we see expressed here, if we want to determine the limit of these vector-valued functions, we can see that we just need to take the limit of each component individually to determine the limit of the vector-valued function. Whether it's in two dimensions or three dimensions, will determine whether we have two limits or three limits to evaluate. So for the most part, this will feel like a review of how to determine limits for functions. Let's go ahead and look at our examples. So if we want to determine the limit as t approaches zero of the vector-valued function r of t, we need to find the limit as t approaches zero of e to the power of t times the unit vector I plus the limit as t approaches 0 of sine t over t times the unit vector j. Well, as t approaches 0, this exponent is approaching 0, and e to the 0 would be equal to 1, so we're going to have 1 times the unit vector I plus, now as t approaches 0, notice that the numerator and denominator approach 0, which is an indeterminate form. So here we're going to have to apply L'Hopital's rule, where instead of evaluating this limit, we can take the limit as t approaches 0 of the derivative of the numerator and the derivative of the denominator. Well, the derivative of sine t would be cosine t. The derivative of t would be 1. And now we can evaluate this limit, because as t approaches 0, well, cosine 0 would be equal to 1, so we'd have 1 over 1, so this limit would equal 1. So we have 1i plus 1j, or in component form, the x component would be 1, and the y component would be 1. Let's go and take a look at another one. Here we have an x, y, and z component, so we're going to have to determine three limits. We'll have the limit as t approaches pi over 4 of sine squared t times the unit vector I plus the limit as t approaches pi over 4 of tangent t times the unit vector j, and then lastly plus the limit as t approaches pi over 4 of 1 over t times vector k. For this first limit, as t approaches pi over 4, sine t is going to approach sine pi over 4. Well, the sine of pi over 4 is 1 over square root 2, but then it's going to be squared, so we're going to have 1 over square root 2 squared as our limit times the unit vector I. We'll simplify this in the next step. Plus, as t approaches pi over 4, this will approach tangent pi over 4, which is equal to 1. So we'll have 1 times the unit vector j plus, now as t approaches pi over 4, this is going to approach 1 over pi over 4. Well, 1 over pi over 4 would be 4 over pi, or the reciprocal. So we have 4 pi times the unit vector k. So here we'd have 1 squared over square root 2 squared. That's going to be 1 half I plus j, this will be plus 4 pi k. This is going to be our limit. In component form, we'll have 1 half, 1, and 4 over pi. Again, we normally don't have to express this limit in both forms, but depending on the textbook you're reading, they may express it in either way. Let's go ahead and look at one more. Here we want to determine the limit as t approaches infinity of the vector-valued function r of t. Notice again we will have three limits to determine because we have an x, y, and z component. So we're going to have the limit as t approaches infinity of 2 over t plus the limit as t approaches infinity t cubed over 2t cubed minus 8. And then lastly, we have the limit as t approaches infinity of e to the negative t, but I'm going to go ahead and express this as 1 over e to the t. It's going to help us evaluate that limit. So for this first limit, t is approaching infinity, and our function is 2 over t. So our numerator is fixed, our denominator is increasing without bound. This is going to approach 0. Or if you remember the shortcut here, our numerator is degree 0, our denominator is degree 1, and since the denominator has a higher degree, this will always approach 0. So we'd have 0 times the unit vector I plus, notice on this function the degree of the numerator and denominator are the same. And the shortcut here is that if the degrees are the same, the limit as t approaches infinity will be the ratio of the leading coefficients, or 1 over 2. So we'd have 1 half times the unit vector j plus. Now for this last limit, you can see why I wanted to rewrite e to the negative t as 1 over e to the t. In this form, we have a fixed numerator, and as t approaches infinity, our denominator is increasing without bound. So 1 over an increasing denominator would be approaching 0. So we have 0 times the unit vector k. So we can rewrite this as 1 half j, or in component form, we would have 0, 1 half, and 0. So as you can see, determining the limit of a vector valued function is for the most part just reviewing how to determine limits in general. I hope you found this video helpful.